I'll start by saying, as you know, the name of the book is American Hate, Survivors Speak Out. A lot of us are fatigued. And a lot of us have difficulty talking about these issues because they're painful, they're hurtful, and there's a lot of grief in this moment. But if you stay with me this evening, I think you will find that there are plenty of reasons to be hopeful, optimistic about the future of this country, because all the survivors who I met, all the survivors who are profiled in my book, have suffered hate in America, but they are profoundly strong and resilient people. So with that, let's go ahead and jump right in. I'm going to talk for about 10 minutes to introduce the book. I'll read from a few of the testimonials, and then we'll open it up to questions. So I'm a community activist. I work closely with Muslim, Arab, South Asian, and Sikhs in America. And what I was hearing during the 2016 presidential election was that hate was spiking in every facet of American life. In the classroom, in the university, workplace, public life. And that spike, that intensification, really continued on through inauguration and under the Trump administration. And so I thought it was important to travel the country, meet with survivors in their homes, houses of worship, community centers, and hear their stories. And that's really what American Hate, Survivors Speak Out is. I've written an introduction which situates this political moment, a conclusion that focuses almost entirely on best practices for how we move past hate, how we support survivors, how to be allies. But between those bookends are 14 testimonials from people who have been directly impacted by hate in some form or another in Donald Trump's America. You will find a diversity of perspectives: Muslim, Jewish, queer, trans, Sikh, South Asian, refugee, undocumented. I decided to include all of those perspectives because really it's open season on all of those communities. Furthermore, when I initially set out, I had thought to only include the most searing examples of hate violence in the book. So think assault, murder. But then I realized that I would be doing a disservice to communities because hate manifests in so many different ways, which is why in American Hate, Survivors Speak Out, you will find one story of bullying. You will find a few stories of very vicious cyber trolling. You will find stories of vandalism and arson of houses of worship. And in some cases, you will find stories of murder and families who've lost loved ones to hate violence. I used the word testimonial earlier. Let me sort of unpack what that means. So many survivors of hate and state violence in this country feel that their stories are reduced to headlines and sound bites. The media might be interested in it for a few hours, a few days, if you're lucky, and then they pivot back to Russia, or they pivot back to humanizing white supremacists, which the media seems to be more interested in doing than actually humanizing survivors of hate state violence. So I thought one way to actually give agency to survivors was through a testimonial. So the process of creating a testimonial was the following. I would meet with survivors, most often in person, again in their homes, houses of worship, community centers. And I would sit down with them, and I would then transcribe the interview. And the interview would be anywhere from 10 to 50,000 words. I would then condense the interview to anywhere between 2,500 to 5,000 words. And then I would send it to the survivors. I will tell you that the day I hit send on the draft testimonials to the 14 people profiled in the book, I did experience a moment of terror because I worried that even though it was in their words, there was a lot that I had to take out. There were little transitions that had to be added here and there. In some cases, again, it was their words, but I was reordering it so that it could actually appear in a book and sort of be compelling in that kind of way. And fortunately, every survivor in due time followed up with me, was extremely grateful about being included in the book, and felt that this really was their story. And one of the things I'm trying to also do, and I just did this two nights ago in Denver, is actually have community conversations in all the cities where the survivors reside. So just in Denver two nights ago, we had 100 people at the Tattered Cover bookstore. And I was in conversation with Jeanette Vizguerra, who I'm gonna be reading from in a little bit. So really that's American Hate, Survivors Speak Out. So with that, I'm gonna go ahead and jump right in to a few of the testimonials. But before I do that, let me read a little bit from the introduction. So again, these are my words and just some of what I saw, you know, traveling the country and meeting with survivors of hate across the country. The suffering and pain in these stories is sometimes hard to bear, and I experienced many moments of outrage and sadness in gathering them and editing this book. But alongside the grief, you will find stories of survival and resistance. You will even find unexpected and stirring examples of reconciliation and forgiveness in the most trying and painful of circumstances. A single hateful act can reveal in the worst in humanity and the response the most compassionate. There is no better way to tell these stories than in the words of survivors. For too long, the stories of those who have lost so much have been told by others. When the media produces content about vulnerable communities, they tend to marginalize and exclude us. Our experiences are described and depicted by people we do not know, and our pain and hurt are reduced to a single headline or soundbite. In the Trump era in particular, it has become almost trendy to speak, write, produce, and direct material about marginalized communities. But rarely do the purveyors of content sit down and speak at length with survivors. Rarely do they visit them in their homes. Rarely do they see how hate has impacted their everyday lives, their communities, and those around them. The survivors in this book repeatedly express this concern. And then moving forward. Reading the stories that follow is an extraordinary honor and privilege. Consider it a gift from survivors. They want to leave the world a better place than they found it. As I've traveled across the country, I have come to realize that in many ways, the purpose of hate is to silence. It seeks to subjugate and exterminate and to do away with difference and uniqueness. The individuals whose stories you will now read refuse to be silenced. Speaking out is the most basic and vital form of resistance. The first story I'm going to read from is Taylor Dumpson. How many of you out of curiosity know the name Taylor Dumpson? So Taylor Dumpson was the first African-American woman to ever be elected student body president at American University. American University is in Washington, D.C., 5 miles from the White House. She wins election last year. The day that Taylor takes office, May 1st, 2017, nooses are found hanging across campus. So I'm going to read a little bit from Taylor's story about what happened on campus, how she responded, but I'm going to start by actually reading the introduction to her testimonial, the first two paragraphs, because it gets at a really important point that I want to make sure we don't lose sight of. She talks about an incident of hate she experienced during the Obama years, right? And I just want folks to be clear that hate pre-existed Donald Trump. Hate will exist after Donald Trump. But he's nevertheless intensified it, and that's a lot of what sort of the book is about and what this discussion will be about. So here are a few paragraphs from Taylor's story. I was 13 years old the first time I heard someone say the word nigger. I was in seventh grade and all of my classmates had gathered for a school assembly. Hundreds of us sat on bleachers and a black student inadvertently poked a white student with his knee. She turned around angrily and called him a nigger. Later in class, she asked me if I was mad, and I said yes, and told her she shouldn't have used that word. She started crying, so the white students consoled her and told the teacher. My teacher then told me to get a dictionary, look up the word, and read the definition out loud. The first definition was a lazy person. As I read it, the teacher interjected and said perhaps that was what the student meant. My teacher ignored the discriminatory and derogatory meaning of the word nigger and humiliated me in front of the entire class. This was just after the first inauguration of President Obama. I was 13 years old and one of the only black students in my class. and this is now Taylor the day that she takes office. The entire room erupted when they announced my victory. Seeing the freshmen yell in excitement because they had a president that looked like them meant the world to me. I won by just 129 votes. I was sworn in on April 30th, 2017. The very next morning, on May 1st, bananas were found hanging from nooses made of black nylon rope in at least three separate locations on AU's campus. The bananas were marked with the letters AKA, the abbreviation for the historically black sorority Alpha Kappa Alpha, of which I'm a member. Grainy video footage showed a person in a stocking cap hanging them between 4 and 6 a.m. The FBI and DOJ are investigating it as a hate crime, and to this day, the hate crime has still not been solved. The entire black community was targeted that day. So was every vulnerable community on campus, all on my first day in office. It was supposed to be a new beginning. Instead, they tried to knock us back down. I decided to put out a statement that first day because so many students were terrified. I said that we would get past this together and that all members of our community should feel safe and welcome. And I reminded them of the timeless words of Frederick Douglass. If there is no struggle, there is no progress. And then this is later. Black women have always been at the forefront of civil rights and solidarity work in this country. I'm proud that Black Lives Matter was founded by black women and I support their vision. When black people are free, we will all be free. But I think we should push ourselves even further. We must remember those who are at the intersection of various forms of marginalization, including black queer and black disabled women. Only when the most vulnerable among us are free will we all be free. Only then will we rise. The next story I'm going to read from is the family of Khalid Jabara. Many readers who've read this story have found this to be the most painful one to just get through. It's the longest story in the book, and it was actually in the news again yesterday for reasons that I'll sort of make clear in a minute. So this is the story of the Jabaras. I'm warning you, it's just sort of hard to hear because every system in this country failed that family. So the Jabaras are a Christian Lebanese family. They fled the Lebanese Civil War and settled in Tulsa, Oklahoma. They made a good life for themselves until a white supremacist moved next door. A white supremacist who would call them things like dirty Arabs, dirty Muslims, ISIS, and anything else you can possibly imagine. In 2015, the white supremacist next door ran over Haifa Jabara. Haifa Jabara is the mother of the family. She was hospitalized, sustained major injuries. Initially, the suspect was arrested. This is the next door neighbor. Initially, when his lawyer made a motion for bond, which means basically release pending trial, it was rejected. It was rejected because the prosecutor knew the history of the case, because the neighbor had a history of terrorizing the family, and because he had committed a violent crime against this woman, Haifa Jabara. Fast forward. A new prosecutor is appointed to the case who doesn't know the history. And when defense counsel makes a new, renewed motion for bond, the prosecutor doesn't object, and it's granted. So the white supremacist is allowed to return home next door to the family that he terrorized. The Jabaras only found out the day before. Okay? So then, fast forward a few more months. Khalid Jabara, who is no longer with us, is in his house. He hears and learns that the man next door is shooting a gun inside his home, right? Inside his own home, not in Khalid's home, in the neighbor's home. Khalid calls the police. The police come and knock on the neighbor's door. He doesn't answer. The police come back to Khalid's door and says, there's nothing we can do. We don't hear anything, and he's not answering the door. Khalid explains the history to them and says, you don't know who's next door. This is a person who's terrorized our family. This is a person who's out on bond, who ran over my mother. Police say there's nothing we can do. Minutes later, the neighbor emerges from his house and murders Khalid Jabara on his front doorstep. And this was in August of 2016. And the reason it was back in the news just yesterday is because the neighbor was found guilty and was given a life term in prison. And yesterday morning, he was found dead in prison under circumstances that we still don't know. We don't know if he died of health-related issues. We don't know if he was harmed or if he committed suicide. But credit to the Jabara family, they put out a statement saying that they very much intend to continue their fight for victims' rights because they feel that as victims of a violent crime, they weren't given the right to oppose the renewed notion for bond and that they weren't given enough notice for gun control and, of course, against hate. So I met with the Jabaras in their family home in Tulsa, Oklahoma. I sat down with Haifa Jabara, this is the mother, and her two children, who are still with us, Victoria Jabara and Rami Jabara. And this is just at the end of their testimonial, talking about how they plan to remember, you know, their fallen loved one. So this is Victoria, Khalid's sister. When I think about Khalid today, what I miss most is his laughter and heart. Every Jabara family joke was his. He was so good at impersonations and accents. He was so loving to my daughter, his niece that he won't see grow up. I also know that he struggled a lot, just trying to be, and I'm sad he didn't get to experience life. He didn't get to enjoy it the way he deserved. This is Rami, Khalid's brother. I'm married and want to have kids someday. Khalid will never get to meet them. Everyone loved him. He always tried to help others. Even in his final minutes, he kept my mom, father, and neighbor away from near certain death. And when you read the testimonial, you'll see what he's referring to. And then Haifa, this is his mother. I know that he's gone, but I see him every day. I see him all the time, on the couch, in his room. I don't want to believe it. I can't believe it. And then Victoria, my sweet brother had a heart of gold. You know, one of the things that's so striking about the family is, you know, I met with them in their home. Again, this is 10 feet away from where Khalid lost his life. And Haifa Jabara told me that she's never going to leave that home because so many of her memories of her son are in that house. And for her, leaving that home means losing, you know, a part of Khalid, which is why she plans on, you know, staying there really for as long as she can. So the next story I'm going to read from is Jeanette Vizguerra. How many of you know the name Jeanette, or does that ring a bell? So Jeanette was in the news a lot last year because she was one of the very first undocumented immigrants in the United States to take sanctuary at a house of worship. She is no longer in sanctuary. She has a status at this moment. But her story is interesting for a lot of reasons. One, because it shows the intersection between state violence and hate violence. So what do I mean by that? In her story, Jeanette talks about how when she took sanctuary at the First Unitarian Church in Denver, she and the church received hate mail threatening to blow the church up during Sunday services. Because they gave her sanctuary, people tend to actually blow up the church. The other reason that I included her story in the book is because a lot of people, vulnerable communities, experience state-sponsored violence as a form of hate violence. So for Jeanette, in this excerpt that I'm about to read, she talks about a conversation that she had to have with her young children. I met them for the first time 2 nights ago in Denver, about how one day ICE might come to her home and tear them apart. So for her, an ICE raid, being separated from her family, is a state-sponsored form of hate. And that was a theme that came up throughout the book. There's a trans disabled activist who's in the book who talks about deprivation of healthcare being a state-sponsored form of hate. Because without healthcare, he basically is off to his deathbed because he needs healthcare to survive. So here is the beginning and end of Jeanette's story. In early February 2017, my children and I gathered around our dinner table. I told them that men in uniform might come to our home and take me away. Luna 12, Roberto 10, and Zuri 6 looked at me and listened. They knew we were different from other families. I'm undocumented, and they were born here. The only way I could stay safe was to take sanctuary at a local church and trust that the government would honor the sanctity of the house of worship. Their father and my eldest daughter, Tanya, who's 26, would take care of them. I gave the children explicit instructions. If somebody knocked, don't open the door. If somebody entered, Luna should film. Roberto should run to the refrigerator and call the first person on the community contact list. And Zuri should run to the bedroom and close the door. I feared for their safety. I didn't want to leave my family, but I was scared that ICE would tear us apart. And this is her at the end of her story. As I continue this work in the years ahead, I know that I will experience racism and hate. But I will press on because I want a better future for my children. I also know that one day I may be forced to leave this country, but it won't be without a fight. I will protect what I've earned and built. I will protect my family and the love and community we enjoy. And if I am deported, I will hold my head up high. From the day I arrived more than 20 years ago, I fought for what I believed. My children will continue this fight long after I'm gone. This is our home. So I saw Jeanette, like I said, in Denver a few nights ago, and she actually was a Q&A, and she shared something extraordinarily startling that I actually never heard from her before, in part because I just hadn't been in touch with her in recent weeks. But she said that her young children, and again, you heard their ages, were increasingly being bullied in school, and people were bullying them by saying that they were going to deport her mother and them. And this is happening in a Denver public school. And everyone knows Jeanette and they know her kids because, again, she's at this point of national and perhaps international fame. And just so folks know about the sort of the tradition of sanctuary, there's a tradition, and it depends who you ask, that I think it's safe to say has gone back many decades, where the United States government has taken the position that community spaces, sensitive locations, like houses of worship, hospitals, universities, should serve as sanctuaries and won't be a locus of law enforcement intervention. So that's why Jeanette took sanctuary at the First Unitarian Church. And even to this day, there are hundreds of undocumented immigrants who are still in sanctuary across this country. For the most part, the Trump administration seems to be respecting the policy when it comes to houses of worship, but not with respect to courtrooms. We've seen them go into courtrooms. We've seen them wait outside courtrooms, not with respect to hospitals. Who can forget the searing images of the Trump administration ordering ICE and ICE literally removing a young disabled girl, I think, who is undocumented, who is, I believe, 12, from her bed and enslaving her in deportation proceedings. You know, and the other point I'll make, and this is, I hope, pretty basic, but it's worth sort of being very explicit about it when I mentioned the intersection between state violence and hate violence. I mean, here's the truth, right? If Donald Trump is going to ban Muslims and refugees, if he's going to cage and separate immigrant families, if he's going to roll back protections for transgender students, roll back police reforms, roll back protections for gender violence survivors, of course it's going to put a target on our back. There have literally been many, tens of thousands of incidents of hate in this country where the suspect has specifically mentioned Trump or his policies. If you're still not convinced, you probably are, given that this is a small, intimate group, and given that you've decided to spend your Friday evening with me, But the next time you encounter somebody who says rhetoric doesn't matter, or policies doesn't matter, or Trump isn't responsible, or his policies aren't responsible, remember this. In December 2015, Donald Trump on the campaign trail said that he was going to ban Muslims from entering the United States. That very same day, a pig's head was found outside a mosque in Philadelphia. Fast forward 13 months. In January of 2017, Donald Trump signed an executive order, the first iteration, banning Muslims and refugees from entering the United States. That night, a mosque in Victoria, Texas was burned to the ground. The spokespeople for both of those mosques are in this book. I won't read from them, but just know that they're here and just know that rhetoric matters, policy matters. What are we doing with time? I'm going to leave plenty of time for questions. I'm going to read from a couple more. So the next story I'm going to read from is Sarat Swong. Sarat Swong is a Cambodian refugee, came here in the 80s. He is the executive director of an organization called the Providence Youth Student Movement. It's an advocacy organization in Providence, Rhode Island, that fights against police violence, that fights for police accountability, and does a lot of organizing amongst the queer community. One Monday, Sarat came into his office in Providence, Rhode Island, and found that the equipment had been rearranged, found that knives had been stabbed into the desk, and again, a noose was hanging from the ceiling. Right? And for those of you who know and those of you who don't, I don't think there is any symbol that represents white supremacist terror more than the noose, which is why it's experienced such a resurgence again in Donald Trump's America. So the excerpt I'm going to read from is about the decision of PRISM not to call the police. They decided not to call the police because they believe, as he's going to say in his own words, that so much of the violence they experience comes at the hands of the state. And that in their moment of pain and in their moment of peril, the last entity they wanted to turn to was the police. So let me read that and then I'll provide a little more context. We also decided not to call the police. We are an abolition organization and believe in the abolition of the police and military. Think of it this way. We came to this country because of US militarism. Then we got here and were targeted by state violence like surveillance, the school-to-prison pipeline, police brutality, mass incarceration, and even deportation back to our home countries. The police and military pose the greatest threat to our safety and dignity. So why should we call them in our time of need? If abolition was one of our values, we had to stick to it in this moment. That's why calling the police wasn't an option. The hate crime gave us an opportunity to reaffirm our values and principles, an opportunity to remind the world about who we are and what we stand for. And then later, we use the anger and frustration of the election and hate crime as motivation to do more. In June, after a grueling campaign that spanned 5 years, the city of Providence passed the most comprehensive anti-racial profiling legislation in the country. The Community Safety Act was modeled after its namesake, passed in New York in 2013. The Community Safety Act and the process by which we got there speaks to the nature of PRISM as an organization. We were intersectional long before it became fashionable. But we must remember that legislation won't save us, nor will policy. Only community will. We must remain focused on organizing and community resilience. That's the pathway to collective liberation. That's how we build an enduring resistance. So here's the thing. Sarat's position is definitely the minority, right? The vast majority of people, I shouldn't say the vast majority, but there are many people who experience hate crimes in this country who call the police because there often aren't other options. But I read that excerpt again so that you have a window into the types of conversations that communities are having, especially in this moment. So what did PRISM do instead of calling the police? Everyone was required to take self-defense classes. They doubled down on their neighborhood watch program. They created a buddy check-in system. And they did other things that, guess what? They didn't tell me about, right? That's why it's community defense, right? So again, we're in a safe space today. I'm doing a couple of events in different parts of the country where we know that white supremacists will likely be present. So we have a community defense program actually in place for those events in the event that something comes up. And just so folks have an understanding for how concretely it can work, Sarat shared this story with me, and I think it's so powerful, and it illustrates one of the themes of the book, which is restorative justice. So about a year before the office was vandalized, computers were stolen from PRISM's office. And the staff at PRISM realized, because they're smart, that theft of that nature typically happens by someone you know, or someone within your broader orbit. So what they did was, instead of calling the police, they reached out to their network of thousands, like Anthony's got the sign-in sheet, right? They reached out to their network of thousands of people and said, listen, there are computers that are missing from our office. Our impression is that this is equipment that you'll probably notice if it's in your home or if someone's trying to sell it. We don't want to prosecute this person. We want to help this person, and we want to get our equipment back. Lo and behold, a few weeks later, someone contacts them and says, we know where the computers are. And it happened that the person who stole them was struggling with drug addiction. So the police never got involved. That person got the treatment they needed. And PRISM got their computers back. Right? What an extraordinary example of restorative justice. Let me read from Tanya Gersh next, and then I'll probably read from one more, and then I'll just open it up to some questions. So hate can impact anyone. Tanya Gersh is a Jewish American realtor and wedding planner based in Whitefish, Montana. It's a long story what sort of sparked it, but here's what I can tell you. Between November of 2016 and the summer of 2017, Tanya Gersh's family in Whitefish, Montana, received more than 800 menacing voicemails, emails, tweets, calls, every type of communication you can think of. They would change their number, they'd get calls in the middle of the night. The culmination of it was white supremacists threatening to march on their home, right? So if you still Google her name, you will find images of the entrance to Auschwitz, and you will find her photoshopped head and her child's head. They published her 13-year-old social media information. So this is Tanya talking about how she is pushing back. The other excerpt I'm going to read from her story also just talks about how she relates to President Trump. And it's a real juxtaposition with Sarat, who, as you can probably tell, right, never gave President Trump the benefit of the doubt, while Tanya did. I'm fighting back by bringing a lawsuit against Andrew England, the publisher of the Daily Stormer. The Daily Stormer was the white supremacist neo-Nazi online blog that first started targeting Tanya Gersh and incited and encouraged other white supremacists to target her. I'm really grateful to the Southern Poverty Law Center for representing me. We filed suit in Montana federal court, claiming invasion of privacy, intentional infliction of emotional distress, and harassment and intimidation. I truly believe that what they did to me isn't protected by free speech. They targeted me, and that's against the law. Nothing would have hurt me more than giving up. Being a victim is painful. But surviving and fighting back has brought me a sense of peace and justice. As long as I'm alive, I want to fight and make sure that nobody else endures this again. Plus, I love the idea of a Jewish family in Whitefish, Montana, taking on the biggest neo-Nazi in America. I remember telling my children when Trump was first elected president that there would be no Trump jokes in our home, that he was our president whether we voted for him or not, and we needed to be respectful. When asked about President Trump in some of the early interviews after the incident, I was respectful and said no comment. What did he have to do with what happened to me? Even when he was slow to respond to the desecration of synagogues and mosques, I gave him the benefit of the doubt. Terrible things happen in our country every day, but Charlottesville changed everything. When I watched the television coverage of the white supremacist march in Charlottesville and saw torch-wielding extremists yelling, "Jews will not replace us," and "blood and soil," I saw in their eyes the same people who were terrorizing my family, who called, messaged, and emailed us. This was them in living, breathing form. I can't forgive our president for suggesting that there was a moral equivalence between white supremacists and protesters. That was a moral failure. I now encourage my children to have open and critical conversations in our home, because it's clear that this president doesn't have our back. So I want to leave a bunch of time for questions. I'm not going to read from any more of the testimonials. Just know that there are others. Some of the other ones I often read from. Destiny Mangum and Walia Muhammad. How many of you remember the tragedy in Portland last summer on the MAX train? A couple of people nodding their head. Right, so that was the tragedy where there were two young black women, one of whom was Muslim, and they were on a MAX train in Portland. Three upstanders intervened, and then two of them lost their lives. The two young black women, Destiny Mangum and Walia Muhammad, they're in the book, and it's the first time they tell their story together. That's one of the stories. Asma Abu Kaye is the first story in the book. Asma was the first Syrian refugee to ever be resettled in the state of Idaho. And she talks about how she experienced everyday bigotry, just being a Syrian refugee, a Muslim woman who wears a hijab. But she also talks about how one day her young son was walking in downtown Boise, and someone came up to him and said, "Are you Muslim?" And when the boy said yes, he was punched to the ground. And that's their story. Let me just conclude by talking a little bit about best practices. And again, the entire conclusion focuses on it. But just sort of a few things that immediately come to mind. No particular order. One is, again, understanding the intersection between state violence and hate violence. You know, politicians love to come out and say, "Oh, we are against what happened in Portland. You know, we are against, you know, any white supremacist committing an act of hate violence," right? But they don't want to actually take on policies that incite, that embolden white supremacists, right? Which is why we need to be talking about policies like the Muslim ban, the caging and separation of immigrant families. And honestly, we have to be talking about it in an international context too, right? It's no surprise that extrajudicial drone strikes disproportionately impact Muslim-majority countries. Guantanamo Bay is and always has been a prison for Muslim men. I've served as a legal observer there. Believe me, it's worse than you can possibly fathom. And climate change has hit the global south the hardest. Second, mandatory reporting of hate crimes. So the data that we have is grossly incomplete. So let me tell you why. According to the FBI in 2016, there were roughly 6,000 hate crimes that occurred in the United States. But if you look at a self-reporting mechanism like the National Crime Victimization Survey, there are as many as 250,000 hate crimes a year in America. So why the lag? Why the gap? The gap exists because the FBI relies on voluntary reporting by local police. It's not mandatory. So most local police either don't report at all, they just don't bother reporting because there's no penalty for reporting, or they just write zero, right? So if we had better data, we would be able to see who's being targeted, where, and by whom. Three, I think we need hate crime laws in every state, and we need a strong federal hate crime law. Not because I want to add time to already lengthy prison sentences, right? That's in some cases how some people justify hate crime laws, as sort of a penalty enhancer. That's not why I support hate crime laws, because the United States is the most carceral state in modern history. But I support hate crime laws because it allows us to see crimes motivated by hate as related and interconnected, as opposed to separate and isolated, right? So if you can look at crimes and say, "Oh, well, this person's being targeted because they're black. This person's being targeted because they're Muslim," that allows you to have a deeper conversation about anti-black racism, about Islamophobia, right? And we get that opportunity if we actually call crimes motivated by hate, hate crimes. It also allows judges to prescribe restorative sentences. So we've seen many cases where judges actually, as part of the sentence, encourage the offender to engage in public service on behalf of the impacted community. How many of you remember that story last year of, maybe the younger folks will remember this because it was, I think, all over Instagram and Snapchat. Diane Suh, so she was the young Asian woman who had an Airbnb and was trapped in the snow and then couldn't actually access the Airbnb. Does anyone remember that? Couple. So this went hyper viral because literally this girl, Asian woman, had an Airbnb reservation. And then the moment the owner of the apartment saw that she was Asian, basically said, I'm not giving it to you because like you're Asian. So this video of her trapped in the snow, not having a place to stay, went hyper viral. And she ended up bringing a case against Airbnb, bringing a case against the person who refused to rent her the unit. And as part of the settlement, the Airbnb owner was required to take a class in Asian American studies at a local university in California, right? So that's why we need hate crime laws. The other thing I'd say is, you know, we've got to engage local politicians. I think there should be hearings in every single state in this country, on the state level, where survivors can come forward and tell their stories. Now, not every survivor wants to come forward, but there are many who do. And I think we should provide as many opportunities as we can, whether it's in state hearings, whether it's in town halls. The last thing I'll say, and again, I could literally go on for many, 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 many hours, and believe me, I teach, so I'll spare you guys. Nora's seen me teach before, so she knows. The last thing I will say is, we need to treat racism and hate as public health issues and as community issues. So by that, I mean sort of a couple of things. We know, because of what's called vicarious trauma, that when a community, when somebody is targeted by a hate crime, it has a community-wide impact. That's just what happens. We also know that survivors of hate crime often take twice as long to recover from a crime than any other crime. I was about to say that. I was like, that's not my ringer. Don't worry about it, it's fine. It's an intimate bunch tonight. So again, when doing this work, centering not just survivors, but centering communities, and understanding that communities are experiencing harm, our young people are experiencing harm and trauma because of what's happening to people in their community. And as part of that, treating racism and hate as public health issues. Again, we know, I mean, there was an amazing study, devastating study that just came out recently, which basically shows that black women are 3 times more likely to die during childbirth than white women. You can control for healthcare, you can control for wealth, education, everything, right? And these are just sort of the systematic disparities and deprivation that a lot of people in vulnerable communities experience. Again, there's a lot of things I can talk about, but that would sort of be the fifth thing, sort of not just centering survivors, but centering communities as well because of vicarious trauma, and then also treating racism and hate for those reasons as public health issues. So with that, I'll end because I want to leave plenty of time for questions or you know, reflections of any kind. Or do you have a taker? Go ahead.
Yeah, I have a question and a real quick comment. I didn't understand the two young ladies who.
Oh. Understand oh, okay. So last summer there were two young girls who were on a train in Portland, Oregon, Destiny Mangum and Walia Muhammad, and somebody got on the train, Jeremy Joseph Christian. A known white supremacist. When I say he was a known white supremacist, I mean a month earlier, he was marching in downtown saying extraordinarily hateful things about black people, about Muslims, Jews. The day before, get this, the day before this incident that I'm about to describe happened, he threw a full water bottle at a black woman on the MAX train on the same route. She reported it. Police didn't do anything. So that day, this person on the train starts yelling menacing, terrible things about them. Like, Arabs die, I mean, it's in the book, all the things, like, go back to Saudi Arabia, whatever. Screaming at them in their face. The two girls got scared, went to the back of the train. In the interim, three upstanders, that's what we call people who intervene. We don't call them bystanders, we call them upstanders. Three upstanders intervened, at which point, 2 minutes later, Jeremy Joseph Christian stabbed two of the upstanders to death, and they died in the MAX train that day. It might be the most sort of well-known example of sort of hate violence in sort of post-Trump, but those are the exact facts. And then the third upstander survived, and he's in Portland, and he actually is very close with the two young girls. Very, very close with the two young girls.
You keep mentioning Trump, but you know, just a quick comment, I mean, Obama actually unlocked the floodgate of hate.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I don't think there's so many Latinos, Mexican, and other countries were extradited back to their countries. You know,
so
more than any other administration, okay?
Yeah.
So you know he started.
Yeah.
And that's one thing. And the other thing is, there's a relation between, you know, bombing and torturing in other countries and extrajudicial killings, right? I mean. There has to be some kind of relation.
Yeah.
It's easy. All these people can be killed.
Yep.
Well, why not? What's the problem doing it here?
Yep.
You know?
So on the last point, I completely agree with you, and I in the conclusion I specifically talk about how we need to be internationalist, and that's why Surratt's story is also so powerful, because he talks about state violence here and abroad. So I will tell you, I completely agree with you about Obama, and you know, I say this on page one of the book. We must begin by acknowledging that this country was built on a hate crime, the decimation and destruction of Native communities, and was furthered on additional hate crimes, slavery, Jim Crow, mass incarceration. Surratt and Jeanette call Obama the deporter-in-chief, which he was. So you are absolutely right. And I like to think that I've done a fair job of making sure, which is why I said before, hate preexisted Donald Trump, hate will endure after him, right? But what most survivors say, and what the statistics show, and what communities show, is that it's spiking. It's spiking because, unlike Obama, you actually have a president in Trump who's exercising the worst form of bully pulpit, right? That's what he does. He just fosters hate on the basis of every human characteristic. That's not like, I mean, that's it, right? If you're white, you know, you're heterosexual, you are able and don't have a disability, a man, citizen. I mean, those are the ways in which sort of you're protected. If you aren't those things, you are a target in this country. So you're absolutely right, and it's both of those principles should sort of guide our analysis. So this is all I'm going to say, right? And one of the themes of my book, right, is centering survivors, right? Centering impacted communities. And what I will tell you is this, and this is sort of where I get my perspective, and this is why I personally, and I will say, there is a big difference, like I just said, between Obama as president, just being a black man, and Donald Trump, right? And Obama's politics and Trump's politics. And anybody who says, nobody in this book says that, right? Nobody in this book says, and there are very few people who say it. But there are people, there's two points here, who say that he created some of the architecture, right, that this president was able to intensify. And I think that is absolutely a fair statement. And number two, and this is again one of the guiding principles of my book, is that I think we have to center survivors and we have to center impacted communities. And what I will tell you overwhelmingly is that those who are most impacted by immigration raids, going back years to the Obama years, are comfortable calling him things like the deporter-in-chief because of what they experienced. So for me, that's why Jeanette uses it, that's why Surratt uses it, and that doesn't mean that we can't have opinions. I just think in my world, their opinion matters more because they're experiencing. Some sort of pontificate about it, and then there are others who sort of experience it. Any other questions? Yeah, go ahead.
I know that you mentioned there's some local communities that are in self-defense.
Yeah.
And all this. Do you know if there's a national movement?
The Sanctuary Coalition is a great example, right? I mean, the Sanctuary Coalition is a great example, right? The idea that there are sanctuaries across this country that are serving as protection and are serving as sanctuary for people who are undocumented. So there's some good work happening there. And increasingly, you know, organizations like, you know, yeah, there are national organizations, even organizations like United We Dream, right? They're encouraging folks to, you know, build neighborhood watch programs, and they already have neighborhood watch programs in place where you can sort of see where immigration raids are happening and sort of how to sort of push back and stuff.
So it's interesting that when I ask that question, you go to undocumented, but we've had communities here who've been here forever.
Yep.
Black and Puerto Ricans,
yep,
and other,
yep,
who are not impacted by undocumentation.
Yep.
So I'm talking about those kind of things also.
Yeah, so they were the undocumented community is sort of what came to mind first, because they are very organized, and they're increasingly using and leveraging technology in different ways. So there's like an app that you can now use that uses crowdsourced data on immigration, so you can actually sometimes see where immigration raids are happening on your phone. But organizations like the NAACP now BLM does. Black Lives Matter encourages people to take self-defense classes, neighborhood watch programs, that's sort of maybe the difference between them, right? But BLM doesn't necessarily bring incremental litigation. So there's just differences between the different organizations too. Yeah, go ahead.
I want to know, because maybe I'm not that related to hate crimes.
Yep.
I'm from Colombia.
Okay.
And we don't usually see that in our society.
Yep.
I just wanted to know maybe if you can relate hate crimes with ignorance, or if there's educational matters that impact people or bring people to hate crimes. Maybe they don't know the religions they are rejecting. Maybe they don't know the context,
yeah,
of the people. Do you think it's related? And maybe through educational programs, you could at least bring something good and reduce hate crimes, or is...
Yeah, specifically with respect to hate crimes, I think it's a lot of things, you know. I think in some cases it's, in the United States, it's sort of the history of discrimination against black folks, which is why people are that much more comfortable discriminating against black folks. I think it's the media, right? Look at brown folks in America, right? When was the last time you turned on the television and you saw a brown person with depth? Right? Instead, you only see them on television when there's a terrorist attack, right? Because they want to make it seem like only Muslims commit acts of terror. So I think it's the media. I think it's sort of, one's history. I think parenting is important. I think what we learn in schools is important. Our textbooks talk about manifest destiny. They don't talk about 21st century white supremacy. They don't talk about mass. If they did, if you started reading at a young age, if in the United States, right, if you are a black man, I don't know what the exact statistic is, and you're 23, there's a 50% chance you're either in prison or on parole. I don't know what the exact statistic is, but whatever it is. If you started reading that from the time you were young, alarm bells would probably go off in your head. Well, something isn't right here. So I think education is important. I think child rearing is important. I think history is important. I think media is important. I think, and as a consequence, all of those are places for intervention. Yeah.
It's
interesting that you bring that up, because a lot of they can't force the U.S. to do anything, but what they can do in the context of international bodies and human rights bodies is bring up the U.S.'s record. So a lot of organizations have actually submitted reports to international bodies saying, our detention facilities violate basic human rights standards, right? Like, you can't separate and cage families. That's a violation of human rights law. So a lot of it is kind of just sort of public pressure, but it's hard because this administration doesn't really care very much. That's the thing that's hard. So listen, I just want to thank all of you for being here. I'm sorry that we had that. And you're right. At the end, that's a great lesson, right? It's a great lesson. But one can disagree. He can have a different opinion about Obama being the deporter in chief, but you're absolutely right. What he can't do and what he shouldn't be doing is, insulting and attacking people in this room, and it just shows you, unfortunately, and this can be for the camera too, how far we have to go, right? And we got a long way to go. Fortunately, I haven't had too many, although that's not, I've had people yell, lies, lies, lies in New York, and
yeah.
McNally Jackson was like banging on the window, being like, lies, lies,
yeah.
You're a liar,
Civility.
Yeah.
How do you get there?
Yeah, or just, kindness, decency, right? Like, it's hard to believe sometimes how difficult it is to obtain. But thank you so much. If you want to buy a book, I think you'd enjoy the book. And I'm happy to sign it. And there are events happening across the country. I was in Denver 2 days ago. I'll be at the Brooklyn Book Festival on Sunday. If any of you have C-SPAN books, I'll be live on C-SPAN 2 at noon on Sunday. It'll be an interesting panel. There's somebody on the panel, I think, who's worked with the white supremacists and helped them come out of white supremacy. So it's me, him, and one other person. I'll be in Houston next week, and I'm doing an event with the two young women in Portland. So, yeah. Thank you.
Thank you.